Hello again and welcome to another episode of BitNote with David Collins. This show will be playing some great video game music from two pretty cool games. I hope you enjoy and have a listen. So, to start off the show, I've got music from two separate games that I think I'll play this show. One of them involves flowers. The other involves murder. So, which one should I play first? It's just, you know, if I play the flower one, it gets you relaxed, then the murder one might make you a bit tense, or maybe I should start by making it tense and then relax you with the flowers. But, I think I will start with murder. So, have a listen. This track is from Murdered Soul Suspect. It is composed by Jason Graves, who also played music from another great game I played on this one, Alpha Protocol. He also did music for Fear 3. Last show I played music from Fear 2, and that was composed by the guy who made music for all the other Fear games. By Fear 3, they switched over to Jason Graves. And Jason Graves also did the music for Dead Space a lot and was very much responsible for that. So, I'll start you off with the main theme of Murdered Soul. What you just heard there was the main theme for Murdered. It was composed by Jason Graves, as I have said, and is from the game Murdered Soul Suspect, which was developed by Airtight Games. I start talking about this game on a somewhat unfortunate note, as unfortunately this is the last game that Airtight Games ever made. This game was actually released this year, 2014, and Airtight Games has since closed its doors. It's very unfortunate. They made a few other games, including a Jetpack game that I never played, an exclusive for the Ouya console, which I never owned, but they've also made the Quantum Conundrum, which I talked about previously on the show and had music from one of the members of the presidents of the United States of America. So it's kind of pity because they were kind of like an independent. They were pushing some interesting ideas, but unfortunately, I don't know exactly what made them bankrupt. But I think the low sales of this game probably helped. I'm almost not surprised because I barely even knew about this game until 1 week before it was actually released, and I bought it more on a whim because I figured it had a kind of an interesting premise. Since then, I've seen it, like, anytime I go to the shops or anything, I see it up on the stands and stuff, so I assume that people find out about it that way, but the game didn't really have that much good marketing for it, and I hate to say it, having developed a game that wasn't marketed the best, I know how bad low marketing can help you, but like I said, I bought it on the interesting concept. And what is the concept of the game? Well, it's good thing you asked. It's a contemporary day thing set in Salem, yes, Salem, Massachusetts, with the witch trials, and trust me, that obviously plays a bit in it later. And essentially, you're playing a guy called Ronan, who essentially is trying to solve his own murder. I'm not sure if I mentioned this before, but a lot of games I've noticed seem to start with the protagonist dying. There's Shadow of Memories, of course. Limbo, you don't know if the game has actually started with the protagonist already dead or not, and you have no idea, since the game isn't good with story, but I think the hint is in the title, if you'll excuse me for saying so. And of course, there's even games where you try to solve the mystery of your own murder after you've died, such as The World Ends With You, which starts with you in a Netherland, and also Ghost Trick Phantom Detective. I think both games also allow you to kind of read minds as a ghost, which, especially The World Ends With You, which is what you're doing in Murdered Soul Suspect. So essentially, the game starts with you basically being thrown out of the top story of a really high building from an attic area, having a flashback that gives a nice exposition on your life, slamming into the ground, and then trying to actually find yourself as a ghost, but trying to get back into your own body to illuminate yourself before the guy who throws you out the window comes down to the ground floor, takes your own gun, and shoots you 7 times. Not very nice. It also gives you a nice, ends up giving you kind of like a trademark signature of 7 bullet holes that seem to go right through. So, impressive for the murderer to shoot you 7 times and make sure every single one of those bullets went right through you without like hitting any ribs or anything. So basically, you find yourself as a ghost. You can't communicate with anything, you can walk around, you can communicate with a lot of other ghosts and everything, and the whole thing is basically you trying to figure out who killed you. And it also turns out that, yes again, it is a serial killer. Yes, serial killer is also used in other video games, such as of course Heavy Rain. And so you're not only solving your own mystery of your own death, you're also trying to solve a serial killer. You're somewhat impeded by being dead, but you can walk right through walls, which, well, once you're inside a building, there's a whole little thing about that. You can walk right through walls, which I find very cool and somewhat disorientating at the same time. I never realized how, before I played this game, how often not being able to go through a wall helped develop your sense of structural place. But when you constantly walk right through walls, suddenly find yourself in another room, then walk through another wall and find yourself in another room, it somehow gets a bit disorientating and trying to find out what the layout is. Sometimes I'd even deliberately not walk through walls, just so I could figure out where I was. And then you could temporarily possess people and then read their minds, and you'll nearly universally find that what they're thinking at that time is incredibly mundane or boring or overacted. I am sorry, but I mean, like, World Ends With You wasn't exactly the best in showing what people could think of. There was a decent selection, but I just think that if I could read people's minds, I'd find far more crazy and disturbing and insane and interesting stuff than what either of those games depicts. I mean, half the time people are like just worrying about the Bell Killer. He's the serial killer in this game. And while I can understand why it would be on people's minds, you'd think they'd think of other damn things. And that's kind of it. You walk around and you end up going through a lot of crime scenes. You end up doing a bit of deduction and you find clues, which is kind of rudimentary. You get a nice like cloud of things and you try to link up the things, and you basically move through the game, which is very plot orientated. One of the themes in this game is Julia, who is your wife, who is left before you. And in earlier parts of the game, you actually meet up with Julia just as you die and are willing to pass over. And she said, sorry, you can't go yet. You must resolve something. And you're going, what? I just want to be with you. But you end up cast back as a ghost in the land of the living and just try to solve it, partially in order to, you know, get the... That's kind of your motivation. You want to see your dead wife again. Kind of cliched. But, I think I'll play the music for that part, for her theme, the Julia theme. As I said, it's by Jason Graves from Murdered Soul Suspect by Airtight Games, and this is Julia track. Have a listen. And that was Julia's Theme by Jason Graves from Murdered Soul Suspect by Airtight Games. As you can see, it's kind of a mournful but somewhat triumphant sort of feeling to it, which kind of mirrors the game very well. There's kind of like a bit of motion as you're trying to find it, going through everything, and it's kind of, and I like how it goes. You know, I don't like being critical of games, but I feel disappointed that this game not selling well caused the game company to close down. A lot of times I just blind myself to this sort of stuff and just enjoy the game on its own merits. But even on its own merits, there are problems with the game. It's not just the marketing. And I hate to say it, but, you know, there is truth. The long and the short of it is, I've looked at the game, and to be honest, a lot of stuff is decent. The story is decent, you're following it on is decent, there's some decent dialogue, some decent problem solving, and you get to possess a cat. I completely forgot about that part. You get to walk around. Now, normally when you possess a person, you just walk along with them and read their thoughts, but if you possess a cat, you can totally control it, and then you can run around as the cat, and you can jump on things as the cat, and jump across things, and do all this sort of stuff as a cat, and go through vents. And earlier on, you know, you run into an air vent, and a human guy goes, "Oh, damn, you let the cat go into the air vent," and you're going, "Ha ha ha, cat, screw you." And it's just fun. And I mean, like, you know, that was fun. I mean, you know, a whole game when you're a cat, that would be cool. Actually, there is one I've heard, Cat Simulator, which lets you be a cat and just knock stuff off shelves constantly. But the point is, you know, you are a cat and it's fun, and you jump around, and yes, and you crawl and you climb and everything. And I think the only time I took a screenshot of myself playing the game was, yeah, when I was a cat, which is fun. But aside from that, yeah, it's like, once you're a cat, the rest of the game seems kind of like a letdown, actually. The thing is, though, the game is a nice thing, but it actually reminds me a lot of when I was, basically years ago, when I was like involved in kind of like Dare to be Digital. It didn't quite work out. Dare to be Digital was a thing where basically amateur game development, usually with you get funding, you try to develop a game. And part of the problem, back then I remember, what a lot of people seemed to do was like grab a concept and then try to make it as a game. But the problem is sometimes the concept would be a little screwed over. For instance, listen, look at it this way. Let's say you had a concept that was involving ringing a bell, and let's just imagine that ringing a bell was a cool dynamic. So suddenly you try to make a game around ringing the bell, but then you try to force it. Okay, you got to have the player ring the bell in this scenario and that scenario and all this other scenario. And essentially people were so excited by the concept that they were more focused on trying to force the player to use the concept rather than asking themselves, why would the player enjoy using this concept? I think another game, Sonic Heroes, from the early noughties, was another game that did this annoyingly, and I hated it because it broke up the pace in Sonic games really fast. But essentially that game allowed you to play three characters in one. You could switch between character and character. So what the game constantly did was throw up scenarios where you had to switch to a specific character, and it wasn't even like a puzzle or a challenge to figure out which character you had to switch to. It's like, oh, it's a block, let's switch to Knuckles. So you switch it, you break the block as Knuckles and go, well, that was pointless. In any other Sonic game, that block wouldn't have even been there, and being there doesn't give it a benefit. You're just forcing the player to jump through hoops. And unfortunately, that's a little of what this game is about. You can do some cool stuff in the game, like, you know, you can poltergeist equipment to make it malfunction, but generally you end up doing that in very specific sequences where, you know, for instance, you know, there's someone that's trying to sneak by, and so you have to, you know, poltergeist an equipment to distract someone. It just feels like that there's a very linear path from where you start to where you want to go. And that's kind of ironic, because the place is actually fairly open. Once you get started into Salem, it's actually a fairly open city with a lot of different places to access. And there are even a couple of side things you can do. For instance, sometimes you solve the mystery of a ghost's death, and you talk with them, and then you go around collecting clues and everything. Collecting clues is largely about going around to various places, then pressing X when you see the X button prompts up. It's sometimes a bit more than that. But the point is, it's basically, the game allows you to divert, but it's still trying to bring you down a very clear narrative track, and it's just kind of a bit disappointing. Also, the game is very kind of like polished, a little too archetypical, like an American TV series, drama series. You can almost just see how the writers are just going for a specific emphasis and specific feel, and I feel sometimes it blocks off some of the more weird, or, I mean, I just think maybe a bit of humor, a bit of diversity could have gone pretty well. So, I think I'll play one more track from this game. For a start, there's also this whole thing about demon stuff in it, which I won't really go into right now, because quite frankly, it's kind of a mini thing that's thrown in, and it kind of is a little, is also kind of scary the first time you do it. But I'm going to play some music now from called My Name Is Ronan, which just lets you know it. By the way, some guy on the internet just ended up pretending he was Ronan Keating from Boyzone and just had some fun with that. But and he is kind of Irish, so maybe it kind of works. But anyway, here is another track from that game. And after this, I think we'll finish up with Murder and start talking about flowers. Have a listen and hope you enjoy. Okay, now it's time for relaxing music. Have a listen. And And what you just heard there was Lazy Daydream by Vincent Diamante from Flower by That Game Company. And before that, of course, was My Name is Ronan by Jason Graves from Murdered Soul Suspect by Airtight Games. So, Flower. So, we're on our third, as I said, we started up a series of That Game Company games, and we're on our third game, the game Flower. This is a very relaxed game, somewhat similar to Flow in that you're controlling a small little thing that goes around and then picks up things that make it larger and then picks up more and more things and gets bigger and bigger. But in this case, instead of being a microorganism, you're picking up flower petals. And this is something beautiful about the game. You basically see a flower and you press a button to start a breeze, and suddenly a small petal falls free. So you have limited control over that petal, so as you blow the wind and lend it control and drift across the countryside, you find another bit of flowers on the edge, and you hit the petal into those, and suddenly it picks up more petals and more until you build this gigantic like cloud of petals that fly across, and then you keep going on, and then suddenly you find out that as you get more and more petals, suddenly an area gets rejuvenated. A tree that was first broken starts sprouting branches and becomes covered in greenery again, and sometimes if there's a lot of metal, somehow it gets healed, or all these power supplies start working again. So it's been said a couple of things by the game developer, partially that it's like a dream of flowers, and partially also that it's kind of like more like a poetry than an actual game. And I kind of agree, because even though it's meant to be relaxing, sometimes it's getting all stressed about making sure that the petal flew by the breeze into the right set of flowers and got the right set of petals. But what it's really meant is for you just to relax in it and just keep calm and just fly away and pick up your clouds and everything. It's a nice game. It's actually also very, very short, since which is good if you're like trying to get through a game and just so you can put the music on the radio show. But some people might want a bit more substantive experience. At the same time, the graphics are nice. The gameplay is kind of straightforward, and it's generally kind of a fairly beautiful game. So, I'm going to round out the show with the last track. It's essentially called Life as a Flower. Sorry, the last track I'll play on the show is Life as a Flower. It's very beautiful and starts off the game, so I'll leave it at that. This has been David Collins with BitNote. Thank you for listening. Thank you.